Wow, we're already at the last video of this series. I've produced this over the course of almost 2 months, and yeah, it's been a crazy time. I've now got to get used to a routine again that isn't eat, sleep, produce, repeat. And you're probably wondering what should be the next steps for you. Do you really need to buy your own machine? How should you go about starting to use it productively instead of getting stuck in that novelty phase? Yeah, let's look at that today. This video is brought to you by Pioppoli and their Phenom series, offering large volume, high resolution resin printing at affordable prices. The Phenom L offers a massive 350 by 200 by 400 mm build size, while the Phenom Noir is a true time saver using a monochrome panel for a longer lifespan and significantly faster prints. Check them out at the link below. So where do you go from here? Great question, but that really depends on you. I've tried to stress in this series that you should think about what you're going to do with a 3D printer before you grab one. Now, I know usually 101 or basic series have an example section where they just go through the things we just learned and apply it to a real, fake project. But you know, there are plenty of videos or write-ups on my channel and on others that are either full-on 3D printing projects or just make use of 3D printing where it makes sense. I've linked a few up here. If you're unsure about whether a 3D printer is the right tool for you, maybe check out your local makerspace first. Right now, a lot of them are still closed, unfortunately, but maybe you're watching this video a year after I uploaded it. It is now July 2020, and maybe things are different by then. Or maybe not, I don't know. Anyway, having a known good machine that you can try printing your ideas on is really valuable, and you'll get a much better feel for what's doable and what actually printing something entails than what I can show you on video. Whatever you do, start small. Pick a small project or a simple design to get going on, and just take things one step at a time. And that can be as small or as insignificant as this little piece. This is an adapter my mom needed so that she can directly set her coffee filter onto her mug in the morning. That's now perfect for making just one mug of coffee. You know, stuff like that. Useful, not too much of a time investment if it doesn't work out, but still with plenty of learning opportunities along the way. For example, for this thing to be dishwasher safe, I printed it out of PC ABS because PLA obviously is just going to warp. And with those learning opportunities comes the temptation to start upgrading things. My suggestion, try to understand what is going on before you dive into a potentially frustrating and costly upgrade bonanza. Sometimes just a better slicer profile can make heaps of a difference for print quality and reliability. What I also always find super useful is being able to print different materials. PLA is totally fine for a lot of things, but knowing how to print with PETG, you know, ABS or ASA in this case, polycarbonate, you know, maybe flexibles and nylon, those can really expand what you can do with that same skill of knowing how to print parts. When trying a new type of material, start with a known good filament first so that you can learn how it behaves and how to work with it without having to worry about the material just being bad. And once you figure out how to print it, you can then always step down to a cheaper brand if you want to. And if you run into problems with that, you'll know whether it's bad filament or just an inherent shortcoming of the type of material you're using. Once you're comfortable with your machine, there are plenty of good causes that you can use a 3D printer for. For example, in the early months of the COVID-19 outbreak, there's been a huge demand for printed face shields. In fact, just that small headband that you clip an easily available transparency sheet to. That has worked fantastically well in places where regular supply chains just weren't able to keep up. So I guess you can expect a lot more like that in the future, now that we as a 3D printing community have proven that yes, these machines are able to make real functional parts fast and that people are able to self-organize to make it happen. So thank you to everyone who has contributed to that cause. If you want a big project, there's Enable that you could join, printing low-cost prosthetic limbs. But you know, even just helping out friends and family and printing the little knickknacks they need, that I think is something that already makes the world a tiny bit better. Let's check out some of my subscribers' comments and questions from the rest of the series. Mario is saying, great content, please don't forget Tinkercad. And yes, you're totally right, I should have mentioned that. Autodesk used to have a lot more simple tools, like 123D Design, which was a Fusion 360 light version, basically. But all those 123D tools are now gone, but Tinkercad survived. So Tinkercad is a really simple, I guess actually playful way of designing 3D parts. It's all about starting with a few basic shapes and combining those with each other, cutting away bits, adding bits here and there. It's not the most powerful tool in the world, but it's definitely an easy start if you or your kids have never used a CAD tool before. So definitely Tinkercad is worth a look. It's free, and you know, I guess Autodesk are only seeing it as a soft introduction to then eventually sell you a subscription to their bigger products. Adam is asking, should I use a 0.45 millimeter first layer height on a 0.4 millimeter nozzle, and will that result in a loss of detail? I'm not a fan. Unless you go real wide on the extrusion width as well, you do lose quite a bit of control over how that extruded filament sausage ends up looking. And as a rule of thumb, if you go above 3/4 of your nozzle size, or I guess more accurately of your extrusion width, your filament is going to start squirming out towards the sides, and it's not going to make great contact with the bed, so you end up with the opposite of what you're trying to get. Now, you'd think the extra width would be an issue with small details, but modern slicers, like Prusa Slicer, actually compensate for that and will fit those small spots as well. MC is saying, newbies should know about thermal protection, and yes, I totally agree, but it's impossible to find out if the manufacturer has correctly implemented all those safety features that are needed for a reasonably safe use of their printer, so definitely look at some reviews that test those features. Tom is asking about the resolution of the Z-axis, which I've super briefly touched on in one of the videos, but basically every axis has a natural step size, and on most printers you don't have any guarantee that the micro-stepping that's happening between those positions is reliable. Now, Prusa do something where they let you calibrate that micro-stepping interpolation on their Trinamic drivers, but on most printers the micro-stepping positions can be pretty far off. So on those, in the best case, you can only get reliable position on every half step, so with a common setup, every 0.02 millimeters. And 0.15 millimeter layer heights aren't divisible by that, so yes, 0.16 millimeter layers would be a better choice. But as soon as you introduce auto bed leveling, all that goes out of the window, and basically you can use any layer height you want because you get dithering of those steps throughout the layer. But that's all a topic for another video. Faname wants to know where I get my shirts. On the internet. Takes a lot of scrolling to find these. Anyway, I hope that answers some of those burning questions, and I hope this series helped you get into 3D printing, or if you already knew everything I was talking about, you know, share it with a friend that could use the info. A massive thank you goes out to my patrons and YouTube members for the help with deciding which topics to cover. I'll try to do a lot more of direct voting on future video topics there, so if you're interested in that, there's links in the description. We also do Q&A hangouts there. And lastly, I couldn't have taken the risk of spending the better part of those 2 months just working on a series like this, so thank you to the sponsors that made it all possible. And thank you for watching. I would encourage you to get subscribed and then to comment below what you would like me to cover next. Anyway, that's it for this series. Keep on making, and I will see you in the next one.